The International Controlled Environment Plant Phenotyping Working Group of IPPN, at least what we proposed to be a working group. And I would like to give you some hints to our suggestions and ideas about the aims and the goals of that working group, and actually give you also some background of why we are interested in controlled environments and phenotyping, and what our strategy is and how we would like to implement that in our new facility at IPK. Now, we have a very tough program today. Within the next 2 hours, we shall have 5 presentations and then still leave sufficient time for discussion about this working group and some business aspects like electing the chair and appointing a executive group or committee. And therefore, I would like to ask all the speakers to really keep their time and restrict their presentation to maybe 11-12 minutes, to leave some time for discussion in total 15 minutes, so that we at the end still have half an hour, 3/4 of an hour for discussion and for the votings and so on. So after my presentation, we'll have a talk by Caroline Lawrence Dill about the Envirotron. We shall have a presentation by Jorans Cabrera-Bosquet about extracting trade values and modeling. And then we'll have 2 talks that link controlled environment phenotyping and field phenotyping. The first given by Javier Ciro, and the second by Uli Schur. And then we'll come back to the general discussion. Now, the aim of the working group, as we proposed, is to have colleagues assembled and put together who are interested in assessing plant performance traits under well-defined environmental and experimental conditions that would simulate present and future conditions. And why we think, or why we propose, that controlled environments are so important, I would like to give you with the next couple of slides. Now, this is the place where our crop plants actually have to perform. They have to give top performance, high yields, high stability of yields, of course, in cultivations in the field. I think that's a fact. But the problem and the big issue is that field conditions, and the dilemma is, they are heterogeneous. They are highly variable due to changing weather conditions. And actually, there is heterogeneity within fields even, so that areas in the same spot can differ from square meter to square meter. So therefore, field experiments are very hard to reproduce, almost impossible to identically reproduce them. And that, I think, has been very nicely outlined in a review by Hendrik Porter and colleagues, and Uli Schur will probably also refer to this analysis, where they put together data from a series of field experiments and looked from year-to-year correlation of the traits. And as you can see, the mean correlation is 0.29 between year-to-year, the same species, the same trait, the same location, but just a variation from year to year. So the R-square is 0.08, so almost no information carried over from 1 year to the next year. And I think this is also very nicely pointed out by a very elaborate study, very excellent study, from the European Drops Consortium, headed by François Tardieu. And that is an enormously large study of analyzing 244 maize hybrids in actually 29 field experiments run by 11 partner institutions. And they did 10 locations over 1 or 2 years, and actually 2 regimes, a well-watered or a rain-fed cultivation. So they could assign these to 6 environmental scenarios, and now you can see the outcome of the analysis throughout these multiple field experiments, 29 field experiments. And in particular, I just want to highlight the QTL that have been detected in each of the experiments. And now you see on the top, and the other boxed one is the same location, well watered, but in the year 2012 and 2013. And if you now look which QTL have been detected in the 2 years, you may see there is a QTL here that was detected in that year and also in the following year, but with the opposite effect. So 100% opposite in the 2 years. You will see QTLs detected in 2013 that have not been detected in 2012. You will see QTL detected again differently in the 2 years, present here, absent there, present here, absent there, present here, absent there, present here, absent here. Here's another case present in both years, and here a case in both years. So the overlap between the 2 years is very limited. But if you even look into the same year and same location, and actually here the rain-fed and the well-watered were all together put into the well-watered regime because the rain-fading was very well, again you see the same site, the same year, present, absent, present, absent, present, absent, present, absent, QTL detected in one location, field site next to each other that are not reproducible. So that is, of course, not a failure of the analysis, but it's a matter of fact that the field situation is so variable and so unreproducible. So the way out is not to do one, not to do two, but to do tens of field experiments throughout several sites, throughout several years, and then ask for overlap in multiple experiments, so a huge effort, and still you cannot be sure that you see it again, what you've seen before. Now, we have seen several similar things in a benchmarking experiment that we run with 30 maize genotypes in the years 16, 17, and also this year again, in a field experiment at IPK, and we have seen the same thing. This is the ranking of the 30 lines with respect to plant height in 2016, and this is the same order, and you see a limited match between the plant heights from year 16 to 17, although due to the very large range that is covered here, the correlation is still quite nice, but still there's a big cloud rather than a nice match between the 2 years. That's completely different if we look in the same year and the two replicates in the same year, there's a fairly good match with 0.92 correlation between the two. So it's not a matter of the experimental setup or the data richness, it's really a matter of the years. And in this case, we could very well say that 2016 was a nicer year than 2017 with more sunshine, and year 17 was less sunshine and more rainy, so it was not such a nice year as 2016. Now, one way out, of course, is to use controlled environments like our glass houses, and here reproducibility is very high, and actually we can achieve quite good correlations with the situation in the field, like here a correlation with early biomass detected in the glasshouse cultivation and early biomass in the field. And we could even improve that correlation by changing the cultivation regime, by changing from a constant temperature to an increase from a cool to an intermediate to warm temperatures, and increase from 0.5 to 0.7 the correlation. Now, that has also been pointed out by Hendrik and colleagues. They showed that the average correlation between lab experiment and field experiments is 0.5. So we are, with our experiment, quite well in the good range there. So there is actually quite some hope that within controlled environments there is information that we can gather for field situation. But there is a caveat, and the caveat is that hitherto used conditions in glasshouses or in phytochambers deviate really massively from the situation in field or typical field situations. And that's seen if you look at the absolute values that we see again a nice correlation between the field and the glasshouse in the same year, 0.73. But look at the absolute values of the field-grown plants and the glasshouse-grown plants. They are much taller, although they accumulate similar biomass, the height, the length of the plants is almost double or almost triple the size as in the same time in the field. So hitherto, experimental situations in climatized glasshouses or phytotrons fundamentally deviate from the field, and also that has been pointed out in that review by Hendrik and colleagues. In glasshouses, usually we have much less sun or light. Light intensity and light spectrum is different, massively different from the field. Temperature regimes are different, usually, especially the night temperatures are much warmer in glasshouses than in the field. The variation is not there. The soil, we have small pots. Soil temperature is different in the glasshouse from the field. The area to be explored by the roots is different. We have much smaller pots, pot limitation, and so on and so on and so forth. So the way out that we propose is to go a new way and cultivate the plants under fully controlled conditions in a closed environment, in a hall without windows, no glass, but where we can simulate the field situation as much as possible. So we would like to go within that controlled hall to simulate field-like conditions, including controlled fluctuations, to elicit traits that resemble that of typical field situation, be able there to run specifically designed cultivation scenarios that are highly reproducible, but where we can then deliberately modify the conditions to assess the plant's performance and assess genotypic variation, thus to enable the dissection of complex traits and analyze also the dynamic conditions, and to test even conditions that we do not have right now, but we expect to come up in future. Now that cultivation hall will or has a ground area of 1,000 square meters, 3/4 of that for plant cultivation, and that can be separated in 4 compartments with cultivation and stand areas of 4 × 116 square meters. We'll be able to have light intensities on one side in one compartment up to 1500 micromoles or 500 micromoles in another compartment, and in the other half about 250 micromoles with a spectrum similar to sunlight with a combination of discharge lamps and several LED types and even UV bulbs. Have air temperatures ranges that are typical for outside situations, air humidity ranges, and even be able to simulate increased CO2 levels and even simulate the mechanical influence of air movement of wind so that we could simulate field situations. And within that cultivation hall, I could show you more pictures later on if you wish, we'll have the 2 halves that are either be equipped or will be equipped with a container-based cultivation system, so we will supply the plants with large soil volumes, about 1 cubic meter for each container with a ground area of 1 square meter, and this will even be climate controlled or temperature controlled through a cooling and heating system that we use. Now this site will then be equipped with a crane-based phenotyping system that has been ordered and is being manufactured currently. And on the other side, we will set up a rhizotron system that follows the, or is closely established with the colleagues in Jülich, Uli Schur's department, where we follow the first prototype set up We will have 360 riser boxes here, and the plants will then be imaged for the root and the shoot part in these imaging boxes that move along these rows. So I could show you movies of simulations, but for the sake of time, I would just like to show you some plant pictures. And you see, yes, plants grow very happily in there. And actually, here you see the big fans that we can use to simulate wind. And if you compare plants that have been grown since the seedling stage in there with plants that were transferred after they reached that size from the glasshouse, you see the very clear difference in habits. So I think we can very well simulate more the features of plants grown in soil or in the field rather than in typical glasshouse cultivations. So that makes us very optimistic that within that completely closed environment, we can simulate conditions that are reasonable, and therefore we can get relevant information from plants there. And that's actually the main scope that we would like to propose for this working group, that is to learn more how we simulate, how we create conditions where we can assess with our phenotyping technologies traits that are of relevance for the performance of plants in the field. And with that, I would like to switch over to the proposed aims and goals of this working group, that is to bring together colleagues that have the similar philosophy, so that control plant phenotyping facilities in controlled environment to simulate different climate conditions, but then reach out to other communities, to especially ecophysiologists, agronomists, climate researchers, soil scientists, and so on, that would help us to define the conditions that are useful and appropriate. And on the other hand, to talk to colleagues that are interested in using the facilities or in contributing concepts or technology and method development. We would like to reach out to other communities like the International Controlled Environment User Groups in the US or in the UK and also in Germany, that for many years have dealt with this question on how to grow plants best in controlled environments. And with that, we would like to support and foster the interaction of researchers that develop and run facilities and would like to link with the field facility operators. Now, the goals that we propose is to monitor the development and the establishment of such facilities, to support the interaction with the related scientific disciplines, trigger the development of novel concepts on how to treat plants and how to elicit and monitor the relevant traits. We would like to support the corresponding technology development and address the transfer from the control to the field phenotyping, consider the dynamics of the environmental conditions and the wealth of combinations, and to sort out which are the most relevant combinations to test and use. I think we should also write statements on how we use this concept and what are the needs for further developments, and also inform interested users. So we should enhance the awareness for these facilities to analyze genetic diversity and to assess or associate agronomically relevant phenotypes with genetic determinants. So to contribute to the development of a key research concept for the development of improved idiotypes that we would need even in future with changed climate situations. So this is the basic frame that we would like to propose for this working group, for the interaction that we would like to invite you to participate and contribute. And before we go into that further discussion, I would like to ask my other colleagues to present their strategies and their approaches, and then we come back to the general discussion. Well, I would like at this point to thank you for your attention and like to hand over to the next talk.